Hello, boomers. Welcome to Live in a Village. Thank you for being here right now. We're having a really special day today, talking about Psytrance as the first conference. Various aspects, people who run the festivals, the artists. And Psytrance is one of the genres with multiple layers. Dozens of sounds and countless hours in the studio to find the best frequencies. What makes a great track? How do different artists produce their music? This masterclass gives you the chance to listen to the experts, ask questions, and learn the tricks of the trade of three experts from the Psytrance scene. Please welcome Atmos, Brain Cell, Avalon, and Martial Arts. Enjoy.
It's Martian, not Martial. It's from Mars, not from. Anyway, it's Martian arts.
I approve.
Yeah.
Okay, let's start with Martian. Your real name is Nektarios.
Nektarios. Yes, I'm from Athens, Greece. I went to my first party in 1994, and something happened there, and I really wanted to understand how these noises were made. So went to university and took audio production and focusing on electronics, analog and digital, because I just really wanted to find out what's underneath all this stuff and how they make all these sounds. I just had this interest about it.
Atmos.
Hi.
Hello.
Tell us your first contact with electronic gadgets, music.
Hello, yes. First contact was actually been discovering all kinds of other music before, and the reason why I started to produce was because I always felt like I love DJing. Problem was that I had a little bit too far to the popular record shop at that time, so every time I missed out on any record, I said to myself, well, the only way of getting those cool bass lines onto my mixtapes is by actually producing them yourself. So that's how it started, and I had no shit about anything in the beginning. And it was a tough road of learning all the manuals, all the different systems each synthesizer had, and but it's been all worth it.
I want your age at the time.
22 years old.
22.
I'm 100 now. Pushing.
On my left here, I'm done. Leo, tell the first experience, the very first contact with music.
Okay, so, hi, how's it going? Nice to see all of you. I'm Leon Avalon, I'm from London, and I was a rocker, basically. I was into rock music, vocalist in like punk bands and rock bands, and I got dragged. My girlfriend at the time, she was it was her birthday, and she loved dance music. And I was like, I had to go to this party she wanted to go to because it's her birthday. And I didn't want to go. I wasn't into it, you know. Like, oh, okay, I'll give it a go. And I guess I basically went rocker to raver. I was the last one to leave. She's like, we've got to go. And I was like, no way am I leaving this dance floor. I've just discovered like the music that I've been looking for all my life, you know. And that was it. Something just switched in my head, and the people, everything about it, I just fell in love with the whole culture. And that was it, you know. And then I started making parties. I actually became a promoter, bought a sound system. We'd make raves in sort of forests. We'd go into warehouses, old cinemas, churches back in England. We used to have a really good, like, illegal sort of underground rave scene. So I did that for a while, making these parties. And then I thought I might as well learn to DJ because it'd be quite fun to DJ at these parties we're making. And then it led on to producing, and then to this point now, it's a long story, but it's been a real journey. I'm really, really happy to be here right now.
Thank you. Brain Cell, as the people knows, but the real name is Lau. First name. And tell us the first experience with Jabberwal with music.
Hello, I'm Ralph. Hello. And actually, I started with, like, I was growing up always with music. friend. Everybody wants to have that. And then on one point, my brother actually introduced me to like electronic music, and in the beginning, I hated it. I was like, what the fuck is this? Like, boom, 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 stuff. But then on one point, it just catched me, and now I'm here where I am now. And I love it.
What's the future of the musical production on Psytrance, or music in general? What's your ideas is the next question. We're coming to a new level of sonic experience or not? Just...
Should I answer this? Because I'm not so sure if I'm going to give you a good answer on that. I think quality in music is very required from as a demand from the audience these days, maybe as not as it was during the time when I started, you know. At that time we're actually doing everything on real synthesizers and like it was understandable that there was maybe not the best sound coming, but still, you know, we were judging each other by the interesting parts of the music. Today it's so required that whatever you do has to sound so good. Otherwise, really, you miss out by not being able to present your music in a way. Let's say I can give an example. Even if you write the best book as an art author, if it doesn't get properly published and people can understand the letters they read, it can be the best book in the world and no one will understand it. Yeah, so somehow it has evolved into that. There is a bigger demand of our finished product as a song is really well done. Maybe something I didn't feel 10 years ago that was that, how do you say, the requirement for that.
Yeah. Did you think, so reach the crowd, you know, pleasure the crowd with your music and conquer new audience? That's your way?
Well, I mean, you know, yeah, okay, it's great to tune more people in to the music. It's a great thing, you know, from, you know, whatever, different genres and stuff like that. You know what, I just do it because I love it, and I love making music, and you know, for me it's the best feeling in the world when you see people smiling on the dance floor, dancing to the music that you've created, and you took on the journey and the whole experience. And yeah, the scene has grown, and it's growing bigger every year. I would want to notice things, you know. And it's a positive thing, you know. I think it's a real positive thing. And it's really it's the culture and the scene that we have. I've been in other genres. I've gone from not just rock music, like techno and others. I think what's most beautiful about this is the psychedelic culture, what we have, you know. And here, like, this is, you know, for me, this is the real gathering, the psychedelic world gathering at Boom. And yeah, I think, you know, the speakers and the technology is evolving. You know, the production's getting better and better. Before we go into the production, which is what we're about to start talking about, I still think the most important thing is the vibe, you know. And for me, I get all my vibe from being on the dance floor, hearing other music, other artists. Here there's so many different kinds of music, not just trance, but everything, you know. And I think that's a big part of it, you know. You can learn production, but you can't learn vibe.
Ralph, it's important in this area, good musical education, real, to know music, study music.
You think of, I think it's good if you have like a kind of a basic knowledge of music and what frequencies are and stuff. But I think it's not really necessary to like going to like a proper audio engineering school and learning this shit. I mean, you can do this by yourself, and nowadays it's like it's such much more easy to and you have everything there, like the whole orchestra if you want. So, yeah.
I think there's so many good tutorials as well online. There's so many good tutorials, like Future Phonics, really, really good there. These are just dedicated for psychedelic trance, you know. If you know, when you're having a lesson now, okay, you might forget something that we're saying, but with these, it's great because you can hit pause, rewind. You know, they've got Tristan doing like lectures on there, and Dick, and I'm just about to do one, and these are 3-hour tutorials, you know, and they're really, really handy, you know, if he's
making a sound and like that. If you don't get it, we'll just rewind it and hit play. And I think, you know, online is the best way. YouTube, looking at videos and stuff like that is a really good way to learn.
Thomas, yes. Back in time, we don't have tutorials on YouTube. Even YouTube doesn't exist at the time you start.
I was using the toilet to educate myself. Instead of reading Ernest Hemingway on the toilet, I was reading my manuals. Yeah. That's why I find peace to do it. You know, yeah. It's time well spent, you can call it.
Yeah. Lesson number one, read all the manual.
Read all the manuals. I would say that if you have questions, instead of, you know, getting a blurry answer back from someone that, you know, doesn't really know, that's when you go to the manual, you know, and next time you need to know whatever it is, you can always remember that. Okay, next time I'm in the shit house, there's going to be a manual of the Yamaha TX-81Z, and then I'll know everything about FM synthesis, you know, when they come out. Sometimes it takes longer, but, you know.
Yeah. The good thing about manuals as well is, though, if you're looking for something, you Google it, and that specific answer comes out. If you start reading a manual looking for something, you read more stuff that you would have come to. If you just Google something, you would have gotten that specific answer. I mean, you know, manuals are, I mean, I'm a manual reader as well. And by trying to find something, you run into other things that you read up on as well and get more ideas and get more creative when you are programming a patch.
Did you guys remember the very first track music you did? And what was the experience?
Yeah, so I remember my first track actually, and it was really cool because it's funny you asked this question because I heard it played last night, and I haven't heard this track for years, you know. And okay, the production's not so great, but like I just said, it's, you know, it's just had the vibe and it worked, and it's not all about having the best production, but that is important, especially with some of the new stuff, you know, the progressive, the big drops, having the energy and that. But yeah, I remember my first track, and you know, you look back and you're like, oh my god, what was I doing? The kick's like 3 decibels too loud, and where's the bass and the lead lines? And but that, you know, that all comes after time. And the most important thing, I reckon, is what I always do when I'm producing is get your favorite artist, yeah, and have it in your project and reference it. Okay, so look at what's going on, keep going AV, back to them, back to you. Where's their kick in the mix? Where's their bass in the mix? Where are their lead lines sitting? And keep flicking back to where you're at until you get it sounding where you think, oh, okay, I get it, that's the best one. And I still do it now. I'm looking at, like, you know, the best produced stuff, and I'm constantly referencing it. But reference stuff with that, like, you know, that you want to make, something the same BPM, a track that's in the same key, it's got to be similar, yeah? And I think that's a really important thing. Get the analyzer up. I mean, I love the RME, the analyzer that comes with that sound card. Just get that up, and when you're playing the other track you're referencing, you'll see exactly where their bass is, where everything's sitting. And just, yeah, just try and get it close to that, and just, you know, just keep referencing. And that's the only way. Train your ear. What is a good sound? What does a good snare sound like? What is a good open hi-hat? You know what I mean? You need to know what you're aiming for. Otherwise, where are you going to go? And that's something that's really important.
Rolf, do you remember the very, very first moment you're recording something? Wow, finally, I get it.
Actually, the stuff we done in the beginning was shit. But I think it was coming over the years that we got to this kind of nice production level, and it took me quite ages to get there. But I mean, the first stuff we did was like running around with a recorder, getting crazy sounds, mangle them up in the sampler, and making crazy noises. And that was the thing, like, after a while you get like more and more into the music production, and then you realize, there's quality as well, which you need. And yeah, but it's a long way, but it's a nice one.
And you?
Do I remember the first track I ever made?
Yeah.
Not really. I remember the first record I released was 2003. And it was breakbeat music because when I went to university, I sat down with a bunch of English people, and they're like, you know, what's your favorite music? And that was like back in 2000, like, psytrance is my favorite music. And you're like, oh, that's the hippie stuff, you know. They were like, you know, you need to fucking play breaks, mate. You know, forget about that stuff, you know, just make breakbeats. So we started making some breakbeat with these guys, and the first record I released was breakbeat, and it did quite well in the magazines back then, like Mix Mag and DJ Mag, like played like Fabric and Ministry of Sound and all them commercial clubs, which was good fun, and there's a lot of funk in that music, and I like the funky element in music in general. I think, you know, if it's got the funky vibe and make people dance, and like that's what I go for. And yeah, it was breakbeat. Psytrance stuff I released, the first stuff I released was in Etnica Nets in 2004 or 5. I think it was Phase 3 compilation. Yeah.
Tomas.
Oh yeah, I remember it. I was standing and scratching my head. That's why I'm bald, by the way, you know? Because I bought this sampler from my friend and Sonic sampler at that time. I think it was 8-bit. No, yeah, it was 8-bit only. Had a very short memory and everything, but what gave me the possibility there was that I had 8 outputs on that sampler. So it was basically, he told me, I have now 8 synthesizers. Like, wow, that's a lot, you know? It's almost like Vangelis, if you think about it virtually. Yeah, I mean, I was recording it on a shitty pair of Yamo speakers, you know, that I had hanged from the side of me in the roof. For that, I had a Yamaha reverb station. That was the only effect I had. And some dodgy mixer from Phonix that didn't even have a EQ. It was all racks. It was like a line mixer, you know. And that was it, you know. And also, like Leon said, you know, that actually gave me the importance of using the right sounds from the beginning, because I didn't have any EQ. So since I don't have any EQ, I knew that if I need a kick drum or match it with a certain bass, they need to really match up from the origin, you know. And that kind of gave me, at the same time, I didn't know how important it was, but now I know how important it is to have, you know, the straight right and good signal into what you're doing. Otherwise, you know, is it as we say, you know, if you take one step here on Earth, you know, and you make a triangle out of that, and, you know, just project it out to space, that little step will be light years after a couple of, you know. So that's a little bit like when you make music as well. If you use bad samples from the beginning, it doesn't matter if the Bossring Studio is the most expensive one in the world, they won't be able to make anything sound good anyway, yeah, so. Yeah, that was my first discovery around that.
Yeah, I totally agree with you, actually. So, like, good source material, basically, you know. I mean, you've all heard it probably, you can't polish a turd. Basically, that is the classic.
Polish a turd.
Yeah, you know what I mean? It had good source material from the beginning, okay? But to hear it's good source material, what do you need? You need good acoustics and good speakers. You can have great speakers, but if you don't have good acoustics, it just doesn't matter, yeah? So acoustics for me is number one, and then good speakers and good source material. Now, there's some really good sample banks out there to look at, which, you know, there's lots of bad ones as well, so you don't want to waste your time. If you look at, obviously, producers out there, you must know Vengeance, yeah, they're great. DMS are also really good, Sennheiser. These are really, really good sample banks to look into. Future Phonics just released a really good one as well, and you know, there's some really good, great produced snares, everything out, you know, 24-bit, ready to go. And I think it's really, really good at the beginning to get those three key factors right for making great music.
Let's talk about hardware. Do you guys use some hardware in your productions, and what's the favorite?
Okay, so I love all my lead lines. Pretty much come from a few synths in particular. I think you can have loads and loads and loads of different synths on your computer, but I think you're better off just choosing a few and get really, really good at them. We'll go for synthesizers, a hardware. I love the Virus, and I love the Nord. For software, I love Silent. I think you can get so much out of that. I mean, like, you know, for bass lines, I mean, I make all my bass lines now in Silent. I love it. Amazing. You know, the sawtooths in there, they're just fat. It's a Trillion as well is also really cool. And yeah, that's what I love.
Like favorite? Oh, I mean, I love the modulars, which is all you need. like from the software side, I've, like you said, like Silent is quite fun, and There's Diva from UHE, which I really like because it sounds like not analog, but it's short before. And I really like this one, but I don't use like a lot of synths, maybe 10, that's it. And then mixed it right, learn the synthesizers right, and then you can go for it.
I use modular mostly. I use modular basically. The reason I use modular is not because it necessarily sounds better, because it's analog, digital, and in general digital, which is, you know, even if it's hardware digital, it's an algorithm. You know, it's still, you know, DSP. DSP in 2016 is incredibly good, and there are some very good emulations in software, so you don't have to go and splash out like loads of money before you start learning the basics on a soft synth, and then you might, then you'll have a better view if you want to use controllers, a mouse, or if you want a tactile interface in front of you that you don't even need to look at a computer screen to make sounds. And the reason I use modular is because I don't need to look at a computer screen to make sounds. It just, it changes the vibe of, you know, of using my eyes to look at parameters. And it's just modular, it's just a tactile interface, and it's kind of a game, you know, you need to be smart to make the next thing, and you can break the audio path and you can change it whichever way you want. And it's this total freedom that makes me use it. It's not, it's definitely impractical or practical. You know, you might record one long evolving sequence, and like my tunes went from 120 channels, they're down to 40 channels, because in one channel there's just so many things happening. But I just use it because it's like meditation for me, you know. It's like I sit there and like time stops, there's nothing, you know. This is just making the patch.
Go deep, yeah, to the music. Tomas.
Yeah, you know, like I didn't really have a favorite thing as a synthesizer, even though I love synthesizers, but my favorite thing was a tape echo. I was like a freak when it comes to analog echoes. So every time I saw like an ad in the newspaper, someone was selling old echoes, I was buying them, you know, and just sitting and saying, bah, I could echo it for hours, you know. I managed to keep two echoes only of all the ones I had. It's, one is the Korg Stage Echo, which is basically the same thing as the Roland Space Echo, with a normal quarter-inch tape spinning around inside to record a delay or whatever it is, the echo. And the other one I have is a DPX Disc Echo, which also is an analog thing, but here it's not propelled by this tape recorder. It's more of like a huge floppy disk inside, so it has a little bit sharper sound to it. But yeah, it looks pretty much like that modular system when it comes to all the knobs and all the freedom you can bypass and patch. And for me, this is important because, like, I would never work in an office. So yeah, of course I would if I would have to, but I said to myself that, you know, I office environment makes me not really, you know, get inspirational. So even if I don't use many of those echoes, because they are noisy, you know, and they have a lot of noise pollution coming out, which actually affects your mix in the end, but still, by having them next to me, I start something on them, you know, and just, you know, play with them a little bit, you know, can kick me into a production in no time. Yeah, so that's why I still have all the stuff around me pretending it's like a spaceship or something, you know.
Can you find tapes for the cord, for the tape echo?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Let's see some modular things.
Right. Okay.
What do you bring for us?
Well, I don't know what the level of the most people here sitting. I mean, obviously you're interested in one way or another into synthesis. So I'm just going to go over like the very, very basic waveforms. There's every synthesizer comes with an oscillator. An oscillator is something that oscillates and produces waveforms. The four basic waveforms are sine, triangle, square, and saw. All the complicated waveforms, which is the saw, the square, and the triangle, can be broken down to sine waves. They're just overtones created that are over the fundamental frequency of the sine wave, and they create a buzzier, more treble sound. I mean, this is a sine wave, really basic. This is a triangle wave, a few more overtones. Square wave, loads of overtones. Okay, that's the last one, hang on. The thing with psytrance in general, the main thing about psytrance is to make something like that's gonna tickle, you know, scratch you behind your eyeballs. You know, everyone wants to make the crazy sounds, and they want, everybody's talking about pitch modulation and filter modulation and amplitude modulation, which is basically ring modulation. The most basic form of the sounds that you usually hear in psytrance tracks is like something like one simple oscillator that's getting modulated by a low frequency oscillator. I mean, just really, really basic. Like stuff you hear in tune, you know, all the time. And the thing about frequency modulation is human hearing goes from 20 hertz, which is the really basic, you can basically feel it mostly, you can't really hear it, but that's when you start to hear a tone. And theoretically we listen up to 20 kilohertz, like 20,000 hertz, but only babies listen up that high. As we get older, we start losing the treble frequencies, come down, like, you know, I can probably listen up to 16K, I'll be happy if I can listen up to that. When you're, old, we go down to 14K. Anyway, so anything that's below 20 hertz is low frequency range. So a low frequency oscillator. But if that goes fast enough. Produced because the modulator oscillator, that's the oscillator that modulates the oscillator from which we're listening the pitch from, goes so fast that overtone sidebands are starting to get created. Another thing is using sample and hold a lot. Sample and hold is an extra waveform that you usually find in a low frequency oscillator. Sample and hold is something that steps, that does step values at the time of the BPM of your DAW, or if you're using something analog, whatever your clock is.
You know, you just did the Dark Side of the Moon here, yeah?
Right, okay. So sample and holds, sample and hold output, which is also called the random out or the chaos out, is something that you use like a lot in psytrance to make like you know. Right, basic sounds then. One sound that I hear a lot in psytrance tracks, I'm just gonna go the really basic stuff that we hear in tune, so I can explain to you how they're made, and you can take it from there and like experiment some more, if you will. So we get the song. Simple soul sound going into a bandpass filter. And then if I get another little cable, I can use, every time I hit a trigger, this is a trigger, and you hit a note, I'm gonna trigger an attack decay envelope. That means only attack, only decay, no sustain, no release. I'm gonna have the attack at full, the fastest, meaning the minute I trigger, the attack phase is gonna complete its phase, and it's gonna go straight to the decay. And I'm going to raise the modulation index. Modulation index is something that you use and you read in manuals all the time. It's how much something affects something else. So when I trigger this, I higher decay, you can hear the oscillator, the pitch drifting down. I mean, it's something that you hear in tunes, like, I don't know if you've heard it, I have. No. That's the attack going higher. Kick drums are also made very similarly to how, like, an envelope like here is affecting the pitch of the sound. So kick drums are usually sine waves because in pretty much every soft synth, like Nico Romero and bassism and Ultrabeat, it's normally a clean sine wave that's produced from a computer, and that's pretty much about the cleanest sine wave you can get. You cannot get these clean sine waves from analog equipment because somewhere along the path, the VCA is slightly being saturated, which generates harmonics. I mean, that's how you have an envelope that's modulating the pitch of a sine wave. Here you're gonna hear it. And the modulation index is going to make you from an 808 to something like Goa, the classic SH-101 kick. And when you start going higher, something a bit more modern. That's just me putting more modulation index from that same envelope to the kick. So I'm going from 808, which is the 80s, Goa, 90s. This is about 2000.
The modern stuff. For the 808.
Yeah. Like, you know, they even more attack ones. All right, so that's how you make a kick. Everything's really simple. It's just one oscillator, one envelope. The envelope is modulating the pitch or the frequency. It's the same thing of the oscillator. We're using the sine wave out because it's a sound that has very few overtones. I mean, that's the sine wave. If I use a sawtooth, it's gonna be like this, which is like good for GABA, I guess. Or techno, maybe. But you know, there's more emphasis on the mids and the top end, and there is bass there, but there's other stuff with it. So when you just use the sine wave, you know, nice and clean. Another thing to check out in newer synthesizers, there's Basil, there's Zebra. I mean, Zebra is not new, but there's Basil, which is new, and there's
Zero.
Reactor blocks is something that's very nice, and reactor in general is like it's like a planet where you land on and you're trying to, you know, understand where the fuck you are until you start realizing that, you know, this is how little things work. And things that you can start using are wave folders are doing the opposite of a filter. A filter filters out harmonics, so a filter does that. Oh, hang on. So if I have a sawtooth wave, the filter is open, I'm closing the filter, and I'm just filtering out harmonics. I'm taking them out. A wave folder works the opposite way than a filter does. And it adds harmonics, but it adds harmonics by folding a sine wave. And wave folders have shape. Angle. So wave folders are doing the opposite than what filters are doing. They generate harmonics, but they, I think the first synths that started using wave folders that became known were the Buchla synths. I mean, I'm using a Make Noise DPO, which is a dual Vactrol oscillator, and it's inspired from the Buchla 258. But wave folders are the new cool thing. They've been around since the 70s, but the whole modular boom started making people crazy about wanting to get the next craziest thing without really understanding the basics sometimes. And because there's a big market for this stuff, everybody learned about web folders. I mean, I learned about web folders a couple of years ago, to be honest, I didn't know. But look for synths that have wave folders and put a sine wave in there, because they usually work best when there's a waveform that goes in. It just has one harmonic, the fundamental, and they just work on that. And you make like nice interesting stuff. Right, other classic sounds. Make a lead or something, like go something a bit more go, I guess. Let me check. Right. Nice. Just a simple sawtooth wave. I just want to show something to make squelchy sounds. It's very, the technique is very easy. So simple low pass filter, sawtooth. I'm mapping the resonance. And now from the same oscillator that I'm using the sawtooth, I'm just going to take the sine wave output from that oscillator, and I'm going to modulate the filter's cutoff frequency with that. And by controlling the amount, you get this stuff. FM sounds like these. After this, things are going to get even more interesting. Or drive people deaf or something. Right, other interesting things that you can do with getting a nice riff going and making it nice and interesting. Right, I'm just gonna do this and stop, yes, I do apologize. Right, so, this is last thing. Sample and hold on the filter's cutoff frequency when the melody is playing. Just really simple things. So use the low pass filter again. So no modulation on the filter. If I use the sample and hold, the LFO has the same waveforms as an oscillator. It's got sine, triangle, square, and so, but most LFOs come with a sample and hold, which is a stepped output at every trigger of the clock or the tempo of your DAW, or an SNG, which is a sample and glide, so it does like a portamento to the modulation to the next step, and so you get stuff like that, you just add some resonance. Really simple things. And, you know, stuff that you hear you know, in Goa tracks or whatever. I think I should stop now.
Thank you. It was really good. Just really good. Thank you for showing us. Atmos, Thomas, yes. You bring something to us, right?
Yeah, it's a little idea that I had once. I was waiting on Chen Gobi on the Malaga airport because we were going to go to Tangier, both of us, for a festival over there. And I just, this lightning of information struck me all of a sudden in that car. Maybe it was the Moroccan hash, I don't know. But I actually wrote it down. And this is the only thing that I came up with in that state that I actually remember as a good thing. And how many of you haven't produced a song and when you come to minute 230 or something and then what? You get stuck in it, yeah? So just to overcome that stuck moment, I came up with this idea.
Smoke some Moroccan hash? Is that the idea?
Yeah, that's first. It works. Basically, everybody is piling up this little row of things that become your groove in the song, yeah? It's kick, drum, bass, drum loops, whatever, stabs, and you know, the normal stuff that basically makes the song. You still haven't done your leads or anything, and that's the problem. So what I did was I stretched that loop into, let's say this is 7 minutes, yeah? That's what your song's gonna be. Instead of beginning like a normal person in the beginning of that song, I said to myself, I'm gonna make an outro, because I'm a DJ, so I like songs that has outros that I can mix in another song. So what I did was, I did an outro by just doing as I would do with whatever I had. Let's say like this is an outro here, something, yeah. Hi-hats were disappearing slowly, blah, blah. Amen. Something like this. Yeah, just uneven ending. Let's say this is the best outro you can do for a DJ, yeah, or your song. Like this. And then I said to myself, okay, if we have an outro, I have to mix in that song as well, which means then I went back and made the intro of whatever I had. So here comes a good intro, let's say. I just do this visually, yeah, because like normally you would have to listen and feel for it, but I'm just saying it will look something like that in the end, yeah? Here comes. Something like this, yeah? What all songs have, I don't say that they need to have it, I'm just saying normally they have a certain type of break in the middle, yeah? So what I did, sorry for being slow. There we have our break, yeah? When you start a song, you always think you have all those possibilities. You're gonna make the song of your life or whatever, it's gonna contain your life and be your life, and you live in that song. And it's the best song, of course, you think, because you've done it. And now, I realize when I saw those two columns in front of me, that wait, I don't have any possibilities, I have fucking limits only, you know? Because when you see it visually that you have 2 minutes on each side, that's what basically a normally produced song would be like, say, out of 7 minutes, one minute is outro, 1 minute is intro, 40 seconds is a break, and just gives you like 220 or something on each side. And it's much more easier to produce something around that instead of thinking that, oh, it's never gonna finish, yeah? So seriously, if you ever get stuck, I mean, it might sound funny, try it. You will at least finish a song. You know, so if you can understand what I just did there.
Can you even promise that?
I think someone asked a question, huh? Someone asked a question?
Yeah. No, I was just wondering if you can use Photoshop instead of Logic.
If you can use Photoshop.
Not really, I use spray cans.
Guys, another question. It's important. I saw many young producers at home
laptops producing the first music, but with headphones, hours and hours.
Yeah.
Can you guys explain to this new young generation of producers, new producers, the importance of a monitor and protect your ears?
Before anyone else says anything, the only thing I have to say is that you have to keep it low. You know, there's the hearing, the level of hearing damage is a lot lower than you think. If you listen to many hours on headphones, you have to keep it low. If you want to be doing this for a long time, you have to keep the headphones low. When you mix, you don't mix loud anyway because the eardrum gets too tight, so it doesn't respond naturally, you know, to air pressure. But before anyone says anything, I mean, I think that's it's not bad. I use headphones, but remember, have it low because you're going to damage your ears.
Taxi volume, basically.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The volume they have in the taxi very low.
Yeah,
seriously.
Which is really low, but that's what it is.
Ralph, what do you think about monitors? Is good for you? Protect your ears.
Protect your ears for sure.
Yeah,
definitely. And I use headphones just for like checking if there are some frequencies which are annoying, and then. But normally I use normal monitor speakers. You don't have to get the big ones, like super expensive ones, but just like having like a flat sounding and like with a nice response and a nice bass as well. So yeah, and keep the volume quite low and change it. Like after 10 minutes, the ear starts to like get used to the sound what you're hearing. And if you go there for ages, and you can't listen to anything anymore. You can't mix because you have to constantly keep your eyes fresh, ears fresh. So I do it like after 15 minutes, I change the volume a little bit.
Yeah, so I mean, yeah, it's good to take a little break when you've been listening to it for ages, because you know we are trying to. I mean, this would be my dream, just having six channels to mix. Wow, that's like my God, my dream. That. Yeah, but no, I mean, it's usually like over 100 channels in the stuff I make. I mean, the last track I did was like 130 channels. Imagine we need to balance 130 channels in the mix. Every sound can be heard and whatever. And it's kind of like an analogy I think of is like animals in the rainforest, you know, because like they all want to be heard, so they're all on different, you know, they've all got their own shout, like lions roaring or whatever, elephants, and they're all different frequencies. They want to be heard, so they know that's, you know, they're letting you know they are there, right? And it's the same with the mix. It's about getting everything nicely balanced on that right frequency, you know. And that really is listening to it on different volumes is really important, because when you turn it down really low, you realize, oh my God, like the open hat's really, really loud, but you can hear it. I mean, I love to play it loud in the studio. I crank it up, you know, I'm just going, I'm really bad at that. And you know, but it's good to look after your ears and all that as well, earplugs, everything. But as I say, you know, I'm not the best at that myself.
What about creating music under drugs? Yeah, creating music under the influence. What do you think?
Okay. yeah, for sure. Getting inspiration, of course, from that. That's definitely a big part of it. We make psychedelic music, let's not forget, right? You know, and I'm not, you know, for sure, it's a part that I love and I enjoy, you know, when I'm on the dance floor, I get all my inspiration from lots of things, and for sure that is one of them as well. I love to party, and but you know, it's for me, like in the studio, like as well, I've just got it really for me when I'm doing really, really technical stuff. Like, you know, I've never like kind of been, you know, smoking in the studio or anything like that, but recently I've just got really, really into it, and it's really inspiring when you've been working all day on a mix, you know, and like you've heard it for like 10 hours listening to the same loop, and you sit back and you smoke a nice joint and just listen to what you just made, and it's the best feeling, you know. I love it. I really, really love it. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Ralph, after work, during the work?
No, if you haven't been sitting in the studio, I smoke spliffs for sure. Get stoned.
And drink beers?
Sure, a lot. And I'm German, so
yeah.
I need to like beer. No, but if it comes to like this mixing point and you have to get your stuff ready, I normally try to be sober. Trying to. Not always working, but I'm trying. It definitely sounds better on the big sound system after it.
Yeah, I mean, for me, in most countries it's legal as well, you know. I smoke weed when I make music, you know. It's not that I need it, you know. I've had times where I didn't have weed and I still made music, but I do enjoy, you know, smoking a spliff and just relaxing and making sounds. I mentioned beers. I don't drink beers in my studio, but I went to Ralph's and he got me pissed drunk. But smoking a spliff, you know, like not many, you know, just one light, just having a joint, you know, just having a puff, leaving it there, having a puff later, which is, I'm a smoker as well. So if I have a joint, smoking slowly, it helps me from not smoking cigarettes like an idiot. But smoking spliffs definitely helps. I mean, I do everything stoned because I listen to it stoned. So I want to make sure it sounds good when I'm stoned. Really.
I would say like this, you know, it takes me, or actually it took me some short while to realize that if I smoke during the production time, I end up EQing a hi-hat for hours sometime, you know, and I swear to God, it didn't need that much EQing from the beginning, you know. It's just as you say, you know, you become stoned. So what I realized is that it's very nice to get high every day, but to get high, you know, you need to be sober at least half of the day to enjoy that feeling. And yeah, like, you know, I want to also say that Leon's thing that he said, this is my actually only true reference when I produce a whole day. Towards the end, when I feel I have done my 6 or 7 hours, you know, because if you do more production on one day, I think every person has, you know, you're creative to a certain point, and then the more you stay around that thing, you're going to destroy more, you know. So I said, do it like a 6 hour pass, have a dinner, have a walk around the house or whatever, have that spliff, and I swear to God, you will hear your song with completely different ears, and then you know what's time to go and what stays in that song, yeah. So definitely once a day at least.
It's really important.
Doctor says.
Dr. Ramos. What about the subgenres of psytrance? Do you guys at studio, when we are creating music, are thinking about, oh, now I'm creating this full-on meets morning sound with acid or whatever? You don't think about the names of the genres of psytrance. When you finish the music, this is really good one.
I would say when I produce a song, definitely that song comes from some sort of memory I had on a dance floor, either together with some friends or even alone in the gutter, lying and waking up later. Yeah, but something tells me that yeah, that was a good moment. And normally I have 2-3 of those moments on a long festival, and those moments actually become songs in the end, you know, because during this moment I heard something that I really loved, and like everybody knows, I'm just a thief, you know, so everything I do is basically stolen from someone else in the beginning, but you know, I do it with a touch that it kind of comes out of mine anyway, but definitely rooted to memories in real life.
To be honest with you, like, just get in the studio, start vibing, like, yeah, it's good to, you know, get inspired from stuff at the, like I was saying earlier, you know, you heard the track at Boom, and you go in the studio after that. I mean, that's how I made an EP and inspired from Boom. I did an EP called The Dance Temple with Burning Noise, and that was, we got in the studio straight after the festival, and I mean, it was fully from what we'd heard at the festival and the experiences we had, and you know, that was a great example of that, you know. But yeah, no, I totally agree with the guys.
What do you think? The same.
Yeah.
Did you guys want to ask some questions of these amazing artists we have here today?
One question. You're an amazing artist. You know that.
It's many questions. Okay, let's prepare the microphone. Can we start from over there? Put your.
Yes. Just to see. Over there. Here.
He's right there.
Orange pants, yes. The man. One.
I have a question about something that wasn't discussed here. I think it would be interesting. You know, as producers, we are flooded with a lot of ads about all sorts of plugins, you know, like wave stuff, you know, compressors, EQs, and all stuff like that. And it's usually like it's a bit expensive. And they all say like it's gonna make your music magically sound wonderful. And my experience is that after a few years of producing, only using like the basic stuff of Ableton EQs, compressors, etc., I'm getting a better sound. So my question to you would be, do you really think that you need all these fancy plugins and stuff? And when do you decide to upgrade your gears? And yeah, so.
You want to go first?
No,
right. I think Ableton's compressor is very good to start with. I think more expensive stuff is 5% more if you know what you're doing with the stock plugins. You know, I mean, I've made music using only Logic. You know, when I had to sell my studio at some point because I was financially in a bad situation, so I had to sell everything, and then I was just making music using only Logic 8 and ES2 and everything. If you know what you're doing, I mean, it didn't sound particularly nice, but what I wanted to say is that I've tried a lot of plugins and I've realized that if you know what you're doing, you can make a lot of, you know, great sounds. I mean, there's the hardware stuff, that's the exotic stuff, that's like, you know, Manly, you know, massive passive EQs and all that stuff for mastering. I think that makes a difference. It would make a difference in the studio as well, but for it's not worth the cash, you know. If you really want something because you really want it, like, you know, like you want a pair of shoes, you know, you can run without a pair of shoes. I mean, the shoes help, but you can run without them. So if you want something really expensive and you want to buy it because it's going to inspire you to do something, you know, get it, but you definitely don't need it. You know, there's more power to you if you just use stock stuff and understand how they work. The thing you need to buy is acoustics and monitors. That's the most important thing. You need to listen well in order to use all this stuff well.
But you don't have to have expensive stuff, believe me. I made music, my first album is done on the cheapest shit you can imagine. I wouldn't even tell you because you wouldn't believe me. I would say like this, use the hints that are given how to use a compressor, because actually this is a trick I learned from a magazine, you know. It sounds obvious, but you know, not until you actually realize it and try it, you realize the difference. And you were speaking about compressors, yeah? Often when you compress a bass line, you use something and it's all getting covered by everything else in the song. When you're testing out the compressor, if it does any of the good job that it's supposed to do, because after all, if you use a compressor, results should be better than the original, otherwise what's the point of using it, yeah? Many of the sounds we have are so clean, and since we don't have a live bass player playing wrong and stuff like that, you know, you don't really need a compressor either for that. But use a filter like an EQ and cut off every frequency above 150 hertz. Basically you have the sound when you go to the toilet of the club, you know, there. This is the only place where you actually, when you start knobbing that compressor, you hear things are happening, yeah? So like sitting and listening to the whole production and trying and knowing that you have the world's expensive compressor, it's like seriously shooting someone, you know, from behind and hitting a little bullseye, you know. It's, you're lucky then, yeah? So it's just, you know, how to be able to hear the difference. That was my hard thing, you know, that I had to learn.
More questions?
Hi, hello. So I have a technical question about the resolution that you guys work on, because obviously, you know, 44.1 is the destination resolution, and I did a sound engineering degree in Dublin, and we always had this crazy discussion about, oh, 48 sounds better, but if you do 88.2, then you can split it in half and it works better. So what's your opinion on that?
Oh shit, I like you, really, man. Maybe I should learn something from you, because like, you know, I don't know. I use the 44.1 and I'm fine with that.
Yes. That's the answer I was looking for.
Yeah, like, well, you wouldn't working in a higher sample rates is definitely better. Even plugins, you know, sound better. Audio sounds better, but in contrast to bits, you know, when you go from 16 to 24 bits, the amount of disk space that you will need going from 44.1 to 96K or higher is insane. I mean, it's just impractical because we don't have hard drives. The big ones are very slow and the fast ones are too small. So I think, I mean, I would do it if I could, but at this point it's just impractical for me having all this odd chunk of audio sampled at 96 kilohertz. It's just taking too much space. At some point, I will definitely do it. Right now, you know, it's not practical.
Next question, over there. Another question here. What do you guys think about the whole DAW war that is going around on producers? Like, he says, oh, Ableton is everything and Logic is bullshit and I only need this and that. Why do you guys think your DAW is the one you use? Why not?
Well, I think you need to, it's good to know all of them because they've all got certain things that the other one doesn't have. Like, and I was on Logic originally when I started making music. And then when I started working with Tristan, my voice is going. The last two nights I blasted really hard. I couldn't talk last night, and I'm so happy I can speak today. But if it does go, you know what's going on. Yeah, so I think it's good to know all of them. They all have different things. When I started working with Tristan, he switched to Ableton. He's like, no, this is the one now. We're going to learn Ableton. And then I've just started a project with Sonny Species. He's using Cubase. And I was like, this is out of order. I've got to learn Cubase now. Like, what are you guys doing to me? Like, I'm going crazy. I've got to know all three. But it's actually a really good thing because they all offer other plugins and different things that the other one doesn't offer. I mean, I still really love the things about Logic, but you know, I think you've really got to be looking at Ableton right now for you know, psychedelic sound design and with all the Max for Live plugins and everything like that. You can get those really, really tripped out sounds with Ableton. I think that's the future.
Okay. Over there, another question over there.
Hello, I was just wondering, my question is not going to be technical, I'm sorry. How much do you know beforehand when you're creating music? Do you know exactly where you want to go? Or do you feel like you're like trying things and stumbling upon something good and then work from that?
When I make music, I'll just answer it. When I make music, that's my favorite part of the process as well. My favorite part of making a tune is when there's an empty arrangement, because anything can happen, you know, my mind is running. So I just start recording things and I say, okay, this tune is gonna be like F sharp, you know, F sharp minor. I'm just deciding on the scale. So whatever I do, I make it so it fits into that scale. And then I just get a chunk of audio, I listen to it, arrange it into like 32 or 64 bars, like the basic stuff. And I mean, Thomas's version is very good for finishing tracks. But me, I like to finish the part before I move to the next bit, because when I listen to the track after 64 bars, it's complete enough. And then it starts telling me where it wants to go, and I just help it get it there. Instead of me trying to force things and having a plan, I just, you know, make sounds and then I listen to them stoned. And then I finish the track. I just let it, you know, I just help it get to where it wants to go. I don't really plan ahead. But his version is a lot more practical because I take my time finishing tracks lately.
I mean, my version is only for those people that think they'd get stuck, yeah? Because, like, I'm calling my friends many times and, how are you? I'm depressed, I'm stuck in a song. 2:30 and I cannot move, you know? And it is depressing you because you really want to finish it. I'm just, you know, giving you this hint just to, if you're in that mode anytime, try it and, you know, it will maybe open up a door, yeah?
Yeah, for me, it's like, I'm just starting making music and then it goes in this into this direction, but I don't really have a specific idea most of the time. Sometimes there's a melody or something in the head and you try to get there, but there's a lot of random stuff happening in the studio, definitely.
This kind of space to things who happen suddenly, you know,
happy improvise,
it's good too.
Happy
to creation, yeah, happy accidents.
Yeah?
It's good for creation or you guys?
I didn't hear the question really, what was that?
Happy accidents.
Happy accidents?
Yeah.
All of them.
Yeah.
Like, seriously, many of the sounds that actually I either made into leads or whatever, they happen just by happening. Nothing happens just when just is not happening.
Any question here? Ah, okay, over there.
The gods have answered my prayers. This is, may turn out to be a two-part question, but it's more sort of towards arrangement and keeping energy sort of up in a track. I've really started to understand the importance of tension and release in writing music, but I often find myself managing to finish the tracks, but never being able to keep the energy going. Like when you listen to some of the tracks you guys make, it's just pounding the entire way, whether it's like a grouch track or a prog track or a full-on. How do you keep that energy with, like, you know, not giving up too much in the breakdown, or maybe too many breakdowns kill? I don't know, like, what, how do you keep your tracks energetic and interesting?
I would say as long as there is a foot going, you know, remembering how the song was two minutes ago, that's the way you keep the energy, you know, because in the end, all these things should be loops and rhythms, riffs or whatever, that actually match and help each other. Yeah. So if you end up, let's say, every time you take off three tracks from it, and you feel that it's losing that energy, that thrust it has, then probably some of the drum loops are not doing the job, yeah? Because you can drum that you feel the energy is going against you, that you're the one that pushes the drum kit, and then they have drum loops that feel like you're riding on a horse, you know? So I would say like that, choose the right type of sequence, you know, and then you can also have less sounds, you know? And I swear to God, you know, many of those songs that you like, those parts that are your favorite, actually nothing happens in them, although, you know, something that is favorite for you there, yeah? So it's not about having a lot of things going at the same time, and definitely don't be afraid of turning things off, because let's say like this, why is the kick drum interesting? Because there's quiet in between, you know? If the kick drum was just sounding all the time, it wouldn't be interesting more than once, even when it starts, yeah? So, you know, taking on and off things ends up in, you know, being a variety of song, and at the same time, you know, you can actually check those sounds if they work together in that symbiosis or not, you know, and then that's how I
think you said it right there. Too many breakdowns, I mean, that's really pissing me off right now sometimes, I've got to be honest with you. Just when I'm in my groove, I'm going for it, oh, it stops like that. And I think, you know, like, it's good, they serve their purpose, yeah? You've got to have them in a set. It's all about dynamics, the journey, you know, ups, downs, you know, taking them on, whatever. But I find that you don't need to have a long breakdown in every track when you're playing like a live set for the same music for an hour and a half or whatever. You know, keep the kick and bass going underneath, have it filtering so you can still feel it in the background, but then, you know, build it up. I don't think it's necessary to stop into silence on every track, like in a lot of the progressive stuff. Okay, that's part of the vibe there, but in what we're making, the full-on psychedelic, you know, I think just keep it going, less breakdowns, not 64 bars, just keep the energy going, and that's, I think you answered the question yourself.
Can I ask one more? Just unrelated.
Sure, bro.
Yeah.
This is more so when you're pretty much, you're happy with your whole mix, but, or maybe at the very start, I often, wonder what to keep my master volume at, whether I should keep it at -3 or -6, just so I know that when I've finished my track and I'm about to send it to the mastering, like, should you keep everything at 0 and all the other stuff really low, or should you keep, like, you know, the master itself at a lower volume?
First of all, something in Logic, you have pre-audio metering, it's called. It's an option you can enable there, yeah? That means that the signal from the synthesizer that comes into your program, that's what you see, not what you get when you raise the fader. That actually is not so necessary to know. What you need to know is that your sound coming into that mixer is not distorted, and then I just lost it. Hold on, I'll remember it. No,
when you remember it, you just tell me. Like when you mix something, I generally keep the peaks at -6 dB. Everything, like the loudest peak is going to be around -6 dB, and just to have some space for the mastering engineer to do his thing. But if you turn down the master bus, the fader, if you turn that down, or if you leave that at unity at 0 and you turn everything else down, it's the same thing. You don't lose anything in quality. if you take all the faders down, if you select them all, and provided you don't have any, you don't have any automation anywhere, if you push down the faders, just minus 3 dB, and just leave the master bus at zero, it's the same as leaving the faders where you had them and pulling the master bus 3 dB down. There's no difference in quality, because I read somewhere online some people like disputing about it. But for me, you know, the loudest peak to be at minus 6 dB, that's absolutely fine, because when you send it off to mastering, some plugins clip, like, you know, when you they go, like, the input, it goes over 0 dB digital full scale. And minus 6 dB is a healthy headroom. Plus, it doesn't matter if you send it off at minus 6 or minus 10, you know, the guy who's going to take it and master it is going to turn it up there. You're not going to lose anything. You know, they have expensive preamps, you know, it's not like you're going to send it off to some guy where if you turn the preamp, you know, a bit hotter, there's going to be noise in the signal or anything. So don't worry about that.
I just rerouted my memory and I remember. You were asking about the levels here. So this is actually a hint from the Swedish producer Dennis Pop, who was responsible for Dr. Alban and many other things, you know. Basically, if you have your kick drum ready to bounce out to the last channel, you have to see the main out. After EQ and after everything, I put it on minus 10. And under there, normally, I put my snare drum that's supposed to be equivalent to this one, except it's 1 dB lower. That's kind of the combination you have in between. So it gives you a good, a good start point, because all the other sounds, when you have this formula, actually adds up to themselves, yeah? But the most important thing is that you give the other sounds the headroom they need, otherwise everything is gonna sound completely flat, yeah? So don't be afraid to take the kick down, and always remember that the main snare you have in your song, have it 1 dB lower, and I swear to God, it will solve a lot of problems.
Yeah, he's right. But also, what I realized recently when I've been producing is, okay, so we all know, you know, Israeli production is a real benchmark. You know, these guys are obviously top of the game, and we're always referencing them. But I think it is actually, you know, I think for production, I would say it is for production, right? And and I've realized that, like, you know what? Like, the kick bass is literally, you know what I mean? What I love to do now is have my kick 1 or 2 dB louder than I think it should be on my home, you know? Just have it louder than you think it should be. Like, you know, my kick's at, say, 7 dB, and my bass is at 10, like 3 dB louder than the bass. Always have the kick louder than you think it should be up in the mix in the front, because it's all about the kick and bass. When it comes to production, that's the most important thing, the quality of the kick and the bass, it all starts from that. When you're doing the percussion and everything, that all falls into place. But if you get the mix right on the kick and bass, then you know you're on to a winner with that one.
Yeah, that leads on to my question. So can you guys please share some tips on how to get that perfect balance with the driving kick and the bass?
Listening to it. Seriously, I've been doing it for 20 years and I still don't know how. Every time is a new time, you know, and I'm as nervous as the first time. So you know, if there would be some sort of, you know, Freemason rule about it, you know, I will tell you, you know, and if you know one, please tell me as well, because that's the beauty with it, you know. Let's say like this, every kick drum has its bass, yeah? There are kick drums that doesn't match up with a certain type of bass wave, yeah? This you also have to hear, you know, and I would just say it's your own listening. And to have good listening, you need to have something that gives you good reference, yeah? Remember how many times you guys record something in your studio, you take it out to the car and it sounds completely different. Again, you know, like someone was saying, you can have a pair of expensive speakers, but not until you have good acoustics in that room, or have a pair of at least headphones, you know, studio headphones that you listen to very low. That's gonna be the thing that gives you your answer of, is my kick and bass really driving together, you know?
And it's getting the right pitch, okay? So look at what note you're trying to make it in G or whatever, okay? So go online, Google, and get a pitch frequency chart. It's got all the notes and what frequencies are. So get the plugin called Bassism, and then you can make your own kicks exactly pitched to the key you're doing it. That's the way to do it. Make your own kicks in Bassism. It's a great plugin. And I think it's even freeware, download that or something like that, and get that, look at the frequency chart, look at what key you're in, and then pitch your kicks so they're exactly in tune with the bass. That's really important.
Yeah, because you have to remember that, you know, after all, a kick drum, who's just, as Nectarius was showing here, it's actually a tone, you know, a tone from a synthesizer that is so short, but it still has a certain value of harmony inside, you know, and you will hear a difference if you have a kick that you know is in, let's say, the key G, and your bass line is going in G as well, you will hear that they actually work together much better.
And it's a feeling, yeah. Don't forget, it's a feeling. When you feel it on that heart chakra and it's just hitting you right there, then you know that's the one.
Heart chakra. You sure?
So it's going deeper. Next question.
Hi. So thanks a lot for the funny, very instructional masterclass. You covered a lot of ground, and particularly I was really looking on how to finish never-ending tracks, which was one of my biggest problems. But I wanted to ask you some other question. So I've been working with new interfaces for musical expression, like sensor bays that can capture gesture and everything, and you can actually map to all those parameters on the analog synth, for instance. So I was wondering what's your feeling about the appeal that these new interfaces for musical expression have on the psytrance community, if there's any appeal.
I have to say, I don't know in this case, yeah, but...
Well, there's the theremin. It's been around since the 30s or 40s. Yeah, and the theremin was mainly used by women because it was people thought it was a good show to show a beautiful woman, you know, dressed nice and like doing all these goddess-like gestures and having this hypnotic tone going up and down, because it was just a sine wave that was going up and down in pitch and up and down in level, and that's what the theremin is. I think that, you know, there's a job when someone releases a new synth, and people are asking, does it have a Roland beam synth, D beam, which is like the little Roland beam that they had on the JP8000, I think it was, or something around that era. Anyway, but it makes for a nice show, you know, if you can master it and make music dancing, or you know, it looks cool. I mean, I don't use it, because I'm a bit old school myself. I mean, I use touch surfaces, but that's about it.
Yeah, I think it's also a little bit too early, maybe, in the moment for speaking about this, because it's just coming up. It's just coming up with this technology, and I think it takes a little bit more time to. But I would love to try it out, definitely. I mean, I'm working with Bitwig Studio, and they have this opportunity that you can have more expression with your keyboard, which is like a really new way of like playing melodies and stuff. And I think, yeah, give it like 1-2 more years and then let's see what happens.
Oh? Because when you're dealing with synths and you have such a high level, not such a high number of parameters, you know, producing actually becomes a complex process. But when you're thinking on maybe using the expressive characters, like pulling a filter or just tweaking the LFO or any filters, if you can actually do that real time with like several parameters, that you can really use one knob or two hands only, but you can actually, you know, interact with many of them. Maybe, well, what I'm saying is...
You can do it already in modular with multiples.
Yeah, you can.
You just have one knob and you just molt it out to many things. And there's also, like, I don't know if you can see, there's these cables that have, like, it's a cable that's got a hole for another cable to go in, so you just molt startup file, you know, and you can assign something to a touch surface that the more pressure you put, the more, it's a conductive material, so the more skin that touches the material, the more voltage goes through. So you just control many things like that, you know, you just do one thing. But you can do it right, you can do it right now if you want to.
I have a question for Leon. You were saying silence is what you use for your bass. Now, I've used silence for my bass from in the beginning, and I found that I would always have to like boost it. It wouldn't come out like the full bass sound, and I would have to boost it. So, do you get your full bass before you want to compress it, or do you use a compressor to get to that bass?
I mean, yeah, if you just start from the inner patch on there, and you know, it's very hard for me to tell you. You know, I'm going to do a tutorial really soon with Futurephonic, and I'm going to go really into this, and you can watch it and I'll explain everything. So it's hard for me to show you now. We're running out of time. We don't have time. time to do it. But yeah, you can, you know, and it's about the chain that you put it through, you know. I'm really, you know, putting it through a distortion, the bass, you know, bringing out the tones as well, yeah. So it's not just silent, there's a couple of extra things you need, but as I said, like, I'll go deep into this. And if you know what, if you send me a message, and I'll send you a patch, and you can have a go at that.
I would also want to say to you that with the bass, yeah, to chunk bass up without really, you know, going too far that it starts being its element as it is, you know, only bass. I have this trick that, for example, Logic has something called overdrive. This thing, it crunches up stuff, and it's not necessarily how I want it, but try your silent bass by putting this to zero and then give it the whole full spectra. I swear to God, you think it's not doing anything.
It is.
And that can be that excessive little last of fatness you can get, you know, by a trick like that. Of course, you have to maybe do an EQing or something like that, but just to get that raw chunk, you know, that's a good way to do it.
Next question. Anyone?
So I have one question regarding to bassline and kicks. There was a big discussion about whether to sample the bass and kick just to have it to a certain length, or just have it like MIDI notes playing the silent one or whatever, because maybe the envelope may mess up the bassline with the release. So whether to sample or not.
How you like, actually. I would say just go whatever you are comfortable with. I use MIDI a lot, and I'm not cutting up the bass line and getting one cycle out of it and putting it into a sampler again and blah blah blah. Too much work for me. So I'm like just keeping it real with the synth, and for me it sounds more dynamic. If I play the synth itself, then it, like, I like this kind of wobbliness. I don't need this clean, really super bass line, but that's just my opinion.
The thing with the sampling bass lines or kick drums or whatever it is, that once you've done it, you know, you took a photograph of something, yeah? It's like, let's say that you take a picture of your family and your mother-in-law, you cannot change your smile, you know what I mean? If the arrangement is open, you know, which means that you still have it on a synthesizer, you can do that recording thing to save up some CPU in the end by recording when you know it's there as it should be, yeah? But always try to keep your song and production as much open as possible, because there might be so that, you know, in the beginning that your kick is so bad and you need to change it in the end, and that's going to definitely change your bass as well to it, you know? So it's good to record, it's good to free stuff, but save them, keep them open as long as you can, you know?
I think it's good to bounce it off into audio. It's important because you zoom in and make sure it's exactly, you know, how you're really totally sure that it is starting at the exact beginning point. It's so important with kick and bass, they are starting exactly on time, that it's not slightly off. And the only way you can be sure is bounce it into audio from the synthesizer and then zoom in and look at it. So I think it's important to take it into audio. Keep the synth open in case you want to change the notes to the bass line later. But I think it's important to get into audio. So it's tight, you know, nice, tight and fat.
Hello guys, I wanted to ask if you are actually tuning also your synthesizers, for example 432 Hz from the original 440, because at the moment there is also a discussion going on in the internet, and through my studies I bought a perfect kick and bass. I actually also use bassism to tune my kick then to 432, for example. When you are talking about the heart chakra, you know, and then when I take, for example, the virus, I also have the opportunity to tune it then also to 432, and that's the question I want to ask, if you are doing more or less the same.
I've never done it, and I still play on boom, so, you know, like, I don't think it's that really important, you know, but if you feel better with it, you know, then do it.
Well, maybe we should try it.
Yeah, there is a big... I tried it. There is a big thing on the internet, because, and I like reading, you know, all the stuff. what people don't mention is that by simply detuning middle A to 432 instead of 440, you just down pitch the whole track. There's no magical ratio. You need to go into different tunings than the 1210 tuning that is used on middle A being 440, which is simpler for orchestras to tune. You need to start using different intervals between notes, like the Pythagorean tuning, and good luck, you know, getting all your synths tuned like that. You know, some software does it on some synths, but I mean, here you can do it with tuning notes without a quantizer. But if you're like pitch perfect hearing, you can sort of do it. But I didn't know, you know, I just made a tune. It was, you know, as good or as bad as it always is. But it wasn't any magical sort of difference to tuning it middle A to 432.
Okay, we have finished. The very last advice to these young producers: keep on keeping.
Yeah, just, you know, just make what you love and what you feel. Don't try and be something and try and copy this. Just do what you love and what feels good, you know. And that's what I did. And I was a bedroom producer. Like, I've never even dreamed to be playing here. Oh my God! Like, what? I'd never believe you. I'd be playing Boom Festival or anything like this, you know. I just made what I loved, and that's what I said to you. Just make what you love.
Trying new stuff out and don't listen to us.
It takes time, you know, just be patient. I mean, I've released my first tune like only like 4 or 5 years ago as Martian Arts, and here I am now and I'm 38. So up until the time I was 33, I was just studying from the age of 21 in the university, trying to learn the electronics and like taking my time and trying to understand everything. You know, it takes time. Always remember that the reward is the free time that you have to make music. All this stuff, as amazing as it is, it's a bonus. The reward is having time and making music. That's the most important thing. You know, if you want to do something because you want to be famous, you know, I don't know. Okay, you know, probably choose another genre because of something more, you know, popular than this. But enjoy the journey and just like, don't try, like, listen to other types of music as well. Listen to jazz, listen to metal, listen to whatever, you know, whatever you like, folk music. Listen to other types of music so you don't get too honed in into that same thing that we're listening to in many parts.
And also you have to understand that, you know, like, struggling with music and producing, it can take very long time for people to discover you, but never give up, you know. Like, thanks to why I'm sitting here, is to this mister over there, James Monroe from Flying Rhino. He was the one who spotted me, yeah? So, you know, like, one day it happened, but it's not because of, you know, like, you did something better that day or something. It's just, you know, keep on keeping and one day it will happen. Yeah.
And try making something different. Try making, like, make a techno tune, you know, just for the sake of it, if you like techno, obviously. But if you make different genres, different kinds of music, when you come back to make Psytrance, you're going to have some fresh ideas. And you would have stumbled upon these ideas unless you tried something different. Just experiment, you know, psychedelic music. I mean, we're experimenting with drugs, you know, we can fucking take something and drop dead for all we know. We're experimenting with our lives, but we don't want to experiment with our music. We just want to do the same thing because the next guy did it and he's doing well. Just experiment, you know, music is a form of expression. There's no right or wrong way to express what you have inside you, you know, and it's not a competition. No one is going to judge you.
Remember that
it's not a competition, you know, it's a form of expression, and you want to express what you have inside you with modular synths or with an iPad or with a drum, anything, you know, just have fun doing it.
Thank you guys for your music, for your inspiration, and for this all knowledge you showed here at Boom 2016. Thank you. See you on Tuesday. Thank you.